Welcome back to Real Clear Radio Hour, brought to you by the Competitive Enterprise Institute. I'm your host, Bill Frezin. For the second half of our show on remembering, we're pleased to welcome Rick Green. Rick is a Massachusetts businessman and the founder of the Massachusetts Fiscal Alliance, a nonpartisan citizens watchdog group compiling legislative voting scorecards designed to help voters learn how their state congressmen and senators actually voted. Rick, welcome to the show.
Hey, Bill. Thanks for having me. Glad to be here.
Rick, how did a self-made entrepreneur, a guy who built an auto parts business from zero to $60 million a year here in Massachusetts, make himself the most hated man on Beacon Hill?
Well, I tell you, I think what it is not so much that I'm the most hated man. It's that transparency is absolutely abhorred on Beacon Hill. And I had the either good luck or misfortune, however you want to look at it, to decide that I was going to stand for transparency. You put those two together, and there's a lot of people not happy with what my group, Mass Fiscal, is up to.
Well, why? I mean, you've got a good life. You've got a nice business. Why do you want to mess with these guys?
Well, I tell you, I'm from Massachusetts. My family's here. You know, I went to school here. My business is actually 2 miles from the New Hampshire border. And my accountant and my lawyer for 10 years have been telling me, just get out.
Right.
You know, all you gotta do is move 2 miles.
Vote with your feet.
And my answer has always been, I won't do it. You know, this is my home. I grew up here. I went to school here. I want my kids to grow up and go to school here. Quite honestly, I think Massachusetts is worth the fight.
So when did you form Mass Fiscal Alliance, and what's its mission?
It was formed in February 2012. And the mission is basically to educate the voters on issues of good governance, you know, and sound fiscal policy here in the state of Massachusetts.
So straight reporting.
Absolutely.
So what's the status quo before you got on the scene? Don't they report votes out of the Senate and the House?
So when I started to get involved with politics, which really started in about 2010, when I started to have a little free time, before that I was 24/7 running my business, like you mentioned, I was aghast at how Beacon Hill works. It's virtually impossible for the average citizen to find out how their legislator votes. If you know what you're doing, you can find it, but not online. It's not easy to find. So I decided, very simply, I run a business on the internet, that I wanted to put the votes on the net and make it easy for anybody to find.
And do you need Freedom of Information Act to get the votes, or is there someplace you can go to get them, to report them?
If you know where you're looking, you can find individual votes online, but you have to go through like a dozen clicks, and you wind up with a PDF. You know, it's not a database. And then we have to have someone type those votes in manually, you know, into our database to be able to put them up online.
So they can't stop you from getting the information.
Correct. Although, what I will say is, on the House side, committee votes are not public. Whereas I can get roll call votes of the full legislature, you know, and then I can transpose them. Committee votes, I don't know how individual legislators voted. The only way to get that is you literally have to go into Boston, spend a whole day, and attend a committee meeting in a closed room. And that's if they are allowing the public to view the committee. If they're not, then you'll never know which legislator voted which way.
Why don't they just stream these online?
You know, that would be the ideal situation. But again, when you look at the cumulative effect of everything that goes on there, you have to think maybe there's a reason they don't want folks to see it. I mean, here in Massachusetts, you can see your local school committee or, you know, a local town meeting on the local cable channel, and it plays every day.
Right.
But you can't see how your legislator voted up on Beacon Hill. It's really crazy.
So I'm going to ask you an opinion here. What do these guys have to hide?
Well, you know, just my opinion, but I think a lot of them will go back to their districts and say, you know, I'm for small businesses, I'm for holding the line on taxes, you know, I'm for sound fiscal policy. But then they go in and, you know, they vote a different way, either to please the leadership of their party or, you know, to further other political ambitions. And so, you know, I think they don't want people to know exactly how they voted on these bills.
You do a ranking in a newsletter. I've seen a lot of this before from federal watchdogs. And you rate the top House legislatures and the bottom House legislatures and the Senate as well on a certain criteria. Tell us about that criteria.
Sure. So what we do is we choose votes that we think either affect fiscal policy, you know, any tax vote, budget votes, large spending bills, appropriation bills are going to get scored. And then we also choose votes that we believe go to government transparency. For instance, when the House sets their rules and they actually set the rule to not make committee votes public, that vote makes our scorecard. And I think in the last legislative session, we scored somewhere on the neighborhood of 40 to 50 votes.
Out of how many?
You know, honestly, I don't know how many total votes they take.
All right, but it's not all of them.
No, it's not. So we're not scoring anything on social issues.
Okay.
You know, if something to do with the Second Amendment or some of the more controversial social issues, we stay completely away from that.
So this is sort of a Grover Norquist focused effort.
Yeah, you could say something like that. I think in Massachusetts, there was a group called Citizens for Limited Taxation. They got Prop 2.5 passed, which restricted the increase on property taxes back in the 80s and 90s. We've kind of picked up the same mission that they have in terms mm-hmm. of just the fiscal watchdog.
If I'm a citizen who loves taxes and wants more of them, all I have to do is look at your scorecard, find the legislators with the lowest scores and support them, and find the legislators with the highest scores, just the opposite, and I can still use this survey.
Absolutely. That's the beauty of free speech and of our entire system. Not only do we score the votes, we have a little synopsis online. When you click on the vote, it tells you what the bill is for and then our position. So someone who thinks, you know, I'm against Mass Fiscal's position, they can just flip our votes and, mm-hmm. and they can use it for their own purposes. And there are some legislators who do just that. They're very proud of their low score.
Right.
And, you know, this is what I stand for, and here it is.
Right. In fact, I see you rated one legislator a 0%. That's pretty hard to do.
It is. I think, in fairness, I think that legislator may have been elected in a special election and not there for a full term. So they may only be rated on a few votes.
Yeah, you've got a lot of single digits here down at the bottom, and you got a few in the 90s, not many at the top. But obviously, this is a bit of a one-party state, so it's a pretty lopsided contingent.
Well, and I think the average is somewhere 27% or 28%,
right?
Which is, you know, so on average, that the legislature fails.
So how do you communicate these results to the voters, and who are you reaching out to?
The first thing we did in 2013 is we put up the website. And with that got a good reception. And then this year, in 2014, early in the year, we started by printing out copies of our scorecard mm-hmm. and putting them in newspapers across the state.
Hmm.
So we sent out over 500,000 scorecards to residents across the state, you know, all stripes and colors. Doesn't matter if they're Republican, Democrat. If they're getting a local paper, you know, liberal, conservative,
yep.
they're going to see our scorecard.
Who's financing all this?
Our group is made up of 350 business people, primarily Massachusetts-based. Mm-hmm. I would say, you know, 99%. Don't want to say 100% because, heaven forbid, I find one or two, mm-hmm. you know, who are from out of state, and they'll hold my feet to the fire. Just like-minded folks like ourselves, business owners who are concerned about the direction of the state, who've committed their time and their money to this effort. You know, we're a 501c4, and under campaign finance laws, we don't have to disclose our donors, but I'm happy to tell everyone I'm the founder of the organization. I'm also the single largest donor behind this effort.
So you're putting your money where your mouth is.
Absolutely. Absolutely.
You've gotten some people mad. I think one legislature has called Mass Fiscal pathological liars. What's gotten them so sore?
You know, it's fascinating, but I think if in a climate where, you know, a legislator will vote to not make their committee votes public, you can see why they would be upset when we put all of their votes online, all of their roll call votes. You know, but to call us pathological liars, you know, I think, you know, I turned to Shakespeare, you know, thou dost protest too much. It's not just it's the amount and the nature of these protests. They're so loud and over the top. And this is not necessarily legislators, but mm-hmm. some of their sycophants will call us, you know, racists and dark money and evil Washington insiders, and, you know, just all, even on one website, someone called us Nazis, you know. Ooh. So it's really crazy. But again, I think, you know, I was told when I got into this that people are going to get mad, and that means you're doing something right.
So Rick, are there specific spending issues that you've tended to highlight in your work?
Sure. So one of the mailers we've done over the summer was on the gas tax vote. So in Massachusetts, the legislature voted not only to raise our gas tax, but also to index the tax to inflation.
Hmm.
So essentially, every year, the gas tax will go up. And of course, it never goes down. So once it goes up, it can't come back
sure.
down. So this is one of the votes we highlighted recently, and it's one of the things that's gotten people so mad. But what I find fascinating about this is the legislators are essentially calling us liars, which means that they actually don't support the indexing of the gas tax inflation. You can go around the Commonwealth right now and you can't find more than a handful of legislators who support the indexing of the gas tax inflation, yet it's the law of the state. You know, this is what I find.
How did that happen?
Exactly. So if everyone is so upset and so against the indexing of the gas tax, then why don't they introduce legislation to repeal it? But of course, you know, that never happens. They just want to get mad at my group and others and call us names and liars. But actions speak louder than words. And after they're done calling us names, when they get down to business of legislation, none of them have filed any bills to remove that indexing. And so, I think that speaks louder than anything else that's being said out there right now.
Hmm. You've been accused of negative campaigning for spreading information like that.
Exactly. Just for talking about the actual votes, you know, we're being accused of running really, dark negative campaigns. It's almost silly.
Are there other issues that have gotten attention?
Yeah, another issue that I personally like to talk about is local aid. Local aid is demonstrably down. And in the Commonwealth, local aid is how most of the cities and towns and municipalities, it's a big chunk of money. And it's how it's where it pays for the firemen and the policemen.
Sends taxes back to where they came from.
Exactly. A lot of the sales tax and income tax money that comes back to the towns. And most residents of the Commonwealth, that's where they're receiving the bulk of their services, is at the local level. But over the last 6 to 8 years, which is the time most of these folks in the legislature have been in office, local aid continues to shrink not only as a percent of the budget, but also in real dollar terms. And, we'll just highlight a vote where they didn't allow any amendments to the budget concerning local aid. So it was impossible to increase local aid from the set level they had, which was lower than prior years. And they got very mad about that. And they're all out there saying they're for increased local aid. But you can literally go in and you just open up your property tax and you can see your property taxes going up. And obviously, if your property taxes are going up 7-8% a year, mm-hmm. It's because local aid funding is going down. But here again, there's no website you can go to and actually see what local aid is year by year. You have to piece together mm-hmm. different sources of information. It takes a lot of time and effort. Transparency is a very expensive business. And again, you almost get the feeling that they don't want you to be able to find this. But when you put it all together, the net result is, for most of these legislators, local aid in real dollars is less today than it was when they came to office.
So if tax money is not being sent back to where it came from, where is it going?
Well, that's a great question. Over the last cycle, the state had a $500 million surplus in tax revenue. Yet the governor and the legislature still implemented $500 million in additional taxes. It's hard to know where it's going.
Rick, what role does dark money play in all this?
It's interesting you ask that question. For me, there is no dark money, really. I mean, money is money. There's people with dark intentions, and there's people like myself and my group who want to bring transparency to the process. But money itself is neither here nor there. You talk about campaign finance reform in general, and you look at, historically, in the last 10, 20 years, incumbents win 97-98% of the time they stand for re-election. Yet there's this huge uproar about campaign finance reform and keeping outside money and outside groups out of the electoral process. But when you look at it, I like to put it in perspective. What's the problem with money in politics? I mean, it's one of two things. Either we're worried that money is going to corrupt the electorate, or we're worried that the money is going to corrupt the politicians.
Mm-hmm.
And I think we can all agree is the worry is money is going to corrupt the politicians. So now we have these politicians pushing, quote-unquote, campaign finance reform. Now let's think about this. So if we're worried about the politicians becoming corrupt from the money, you would think we would want to pass laws that make it difficult for the politicians to do corrupt things. Instead, what do the politicians want to do? They want to pass laws that make it difficult for regular citizens to spend their own hard-earned money.
Mm-hmm.
So when you already have 97-98% of incumbents winning re-election, if the politicians can then pass laws that limit the amount that the electorate can spend.
Fewer challengers.
Yeah, exactly. So essentially, campaign finance reform, everything that's been put forward to date, is really just incumbency protection.
It seems to be working.
Yeah, exactly. And the numbers keep going up. Every time they pass some campaign finance reform, you just have a higher and higher number of incumbents winning. Unfortunately, the only way challengers are ever going to have a chance in a level playing field is when outside groups such as my own come in and actually educate the electorate in a grand, big way so that people know how their legislators are voting.
Rick, is it possible that people who live in Massachusetts love high taxes, love opaque government, and are perfectly happy if entrepreneurs like you move to New Hampshire?
You know, I really don't believe that. I mean, I guess anything is possible. And there's probably more of those kind of folks in Massachusetts than maybe in other states. But I still think it's a pretty small minority. Look, even folks who support higher taxes and higher services want their money to be spent wisely. Okay. And when you've got just more and more six-figure salaries up there for people that no one can, you know, there's no job description and there's no accountability. You know, we don't even measure success. I like to say that it's not that smaller government is better. It's that better government is smaller. You know, if some of these government agencies were...
say that again.
So, you know, I think some of my friends on the right, they get it wrong when they say smaller government is better. I like to say better government is smaller.
I never heard that.
Yeah, so let's think about it. Here we have the Department of Transitional Assistance in Massachusetts. If they were actually successful in transitioning people off of public assistance, you know, into productive jobs, then there would be fewer people on assistance. Okay, the net result is you would actually need a smaller budget if DTA was successful.
Right.
Okay, so I think sometimes my friends on the right, we put the cart before the horse. What we really need to do is go into some of these agencies, say, what's your mission? Okay, your mission is to help people move to a more productive job and lifestyle.
Yeah, let's measure you on that.
Exactly. And there's the key, measure it, measurement. In Massachusetts, more often than not, the only measurement the politicians are using is the amount of money spent.
Right.
It's almost impossible to find measurements of actual outcomes. How many folks were actually transitioned? Mm-hmm. You know, how many people did the government actually help? And I think we need to move to a more accountable government structure where, you know, these programs and policies are actually measured so we can actually look at them every 2 years and say, hey, this one's working. Let's invest more here. Or, you know, these aren't working. You know, we need to rethink this. You know, maybe this isn't the right way to go about it.
Rick, your campaign for transparency and efficiency remains under attack. I have a copy of a letter here from Matt Fenlon, the executive director of the Massachusetts Democratic Party, to the IRS, sicking them on you for an audit and to revoke your 501c4 status. Where are you on that?
I want to be clear. My group, Mass Fiscal, is a nonpartisan organization. So it's unfortunate that one of the major political parties in the state would decide to or try to pick a fight with us. But, you know, having said that, I think it's very telling here in the state of Massachusetts. You know, in the rest of the country, you have this IRS scandal, you know, where it's generally thought that potentially some folks in the IRS went rogue and I don't want to say attacked, but put special scrutiny on some right-leaning groups or some conservative groups. But here in Massachusetts, the head of the Democrat Party basically feels fine to openly call...
For that very thing.
Yeah, for the IRS to investigate people they disagree with. I mean, I think that in itself is a very dangerous place to go when you have one political party, you know, essentially publicly trying to use the IRS to intimidate people they disagree with. Yeah, I think that's very dangerous for our democracy. To my knowledge, it's gone nowhere. As a conservative group, you know, we're still waiting for final word from the IRS on our status. So, you know, we've been in the process for, what, 2.5 years
right,
at this point.
Right.
So I don't know that the Democrat Party's, their press release was much more than...
Saber-rattling.
Yeah, a little saber-rattling.
Rick, how can people find out more?
I encourage everyone to visit our website, massfiscal.org, MASSFISCAL.org. There you can learn a little bit about the organization, a little bit about myself, some of the other members of our board, and business people who are involved with us. And there's also a link to the scorecard where you can actually go and see the votes and see how your legislator is voting. If you live in the Commonwealth, all you have to do is type in your zip code, and we'll tell you who your state rep and state senator are, and then you can click in to see their votes.
Rick, thanks so much for being on the show.
Bill, it was my pleasure. Thanks for having me.
That was Rick Green, founder of the Massachusetts Fiscal Alliance, here on Real Clear Radio Hour, brought to you by the Competitive Enterprise Institute. I'm your host, Bill Frezza. If you have any suggestions for topics or guests, please visit realclearradio.org, click on the email Bill link, and drop me a line. Real Clear Radio Hour is produced in conjunction with Real Clear Politics, America's premier independent political website. That wraps up our show for this week. Join us next week, same time, same station. See you then.